Hello, this is Lillian, welcoming you to the 1971st edition of the Enfield Talking Newspaper, Dateline the 18th of September 2014. The readers this week are Beverley, Rod and myself, Lillian, with Colin on the controls. The items that we will be reading come from our local newspapers, the Enfield Gazette and Advertiser, and the Enfield Independent, and are their copyright. Our title music is Country Rock Polka, composed by Pat Frilly, Fernand Boulon, Harry Brewer, and performed by Jean-Jacques Perry, and is used with his kind permission. Local stories include A New Era for News Service for the Blind, As It Enters the Digital Age, and MPs Meet to Discuss Anti-Semitism Issues, Dispersal Zone Put in Place to Tackle Problem. If you are experiencing any problems receiving your Enfield Talking newspaper, please phone Diane de Jersey on 0208 805 6578. She is your listener's representative and she will be pleased to help you. And now Beverley will read the first item of local news.
Intimidation by young people in Upper Edmonton has led to a dispersal zone being set up. The zone, which covers Upper Edmonton between Advent Way and Swathling Close, has come into force after numerous complaints by neighbours about gangs. Groups of young people had been causing problems, and there had also been issues with labourers gathering to wait for work. Police have powers to order groups of young people to leave the area. If they return within 24 hours, they face possible arrest. Inspector Sharon McHugh said, Enfield Police and the local authority agreed there are grounds to believe that members of the public have been intimidated, harassed, alarmed or distressed as a result of the presence or behaviour of two or more persons, and that antisocial behaviour is a significant and persistent problem in the designated area. In particular, it was felt necessary to implement the dispersal zone due to the presence of casual labourers in Advent Way and also youth disorder in Swathling Close. The order will be in place for a six-month period and will help police control the behaviour of specific groups and individuals, as well as being part of an ongoing problem-solving strategy. The Upper Edmonton dispersal zone joins zones in Fore Street and Enfield Town. Enfield Borough Council's Cabinet Member for Environment and Community Safety, Councillor Chris Bond, said, "We will not allow groups of people to harass and intimidate our residents and will take immediate measures in partnership with the police to curb their unacceptable behaviour. We are determined to keep our communities safe and will not allow a small minority of people to wreck the lives of the residents by acting abysmally."
MPs have discussed how to tackle the rising threat of anti-Semitic attacks in North London. Home Secretary Theresa May joined Finchley and Golders Green MP Mike Freer, Chipping Barnet MP Theresa Villiers, and Enfield and Southgate MP David Burrows. They spoke about hate crimes which have taken place in their own constituencies, including one incident in which a swastika was daubed on a home in Hendon. During the meeting, the Home Secretary updated the MPs on the work the Home Office is doing with Jewish security group the Community Security Trust, CST, to tackle internet hate and campus anti-Semitism. After the event, Mr. Freer said, "This abhorrent hate crime has no place on our streets. The Home Secretary will be working with local MPs and others to tackle anti-Semitism and to ensure that racism in any form whatsoever will not be tolerated. Anyone concerned about anti-Semitism can be reassured that the government takes the matter very seriously."
Enfield's news service for blind and partially sighted people, which is celebrating its 53rd birthday this year, is going digital. Enfield Talking newspaper, which has been keeping the borough's blind population up to date with local events since 1961, is preparing to switch from cassette to MP3 format. It is more than 50 years since it started going door to door to play residents reel to reel audio recordings of newspaper articles read out aloud. Since 1976, residents on Enfield Council's blind and partially sighted register who have requested the service have been sent a tape cassette with a news recording every week, free of charge. But ETN is planning to switch to USB sticks containing MP3 recordings before Christmas. We have thought long and hard about this, and we know it's going to be difficult for some listeners, many of whom are elderly, said Diane De Jersey, ETN's vice chairwoman and listener's representative, who is blind herself. But the tape deck equipment and recording technology are not that easy to get anymore. A lot of people really value the service because it keeps them in touch with what's happening, especially people who have lost sight later in life, who miss reading. Every week, the production team makes a 60-minute audio recording of articles from Enfield's newspapers at the Civic Centre in Silver Street, Enfield. The recording is then copied at Community House in 4th Street, Edmonton, and sent to 150 listeners by post. Once they have listened to the tape, they send it back to Community House, where it is swiped, ready for a new recording. To listen to recordings in the new format, listeners on means-tested benefits who do not already have a digital USB player will receive one for free, while others will be charged £10. Chairman of Enfield Talking Newspaper, Philip Dawson, said, "The quality of the MP3 recording will be much better, and it would also allow us to make longer recordings. We can extend the news and notices, and it will also allow people to skip items if they don't find them interesting. Our listeners very much value the companionship that our service provides, and unlike other talking news services, we have blind people like Diane very much involved." Mrs. De Jersey's husband, Keith, a member of ETN's production team, who has been blind from birth, said, "The magazine shows that blind people can get out and do things, and we contribute to getting our listeners' confidence up."
Tributes have been paid to Pam Adams, former councillor and champion for the borough's blind and partially sighted, who has died at the age of 85. Ms. Adams, a Conservative, served on Enfield Council for 20 years, during which time she dedicated herself to improving social services, care for the elderly, and services for visually impaired people. She was first elected in the Southgate Green Ward in 1990 and later was elected in Turkey Street, a seat she held until 4 years ago. Ms. Adams was also Deputy Mayor and was made a Freeman of the London Borough of Enfield in 2007. A public relations officer by profession, she served on various committees and took great pride in chairing the council's social services scrutiny panel. Conservative group leader Terry Neville described Ms. Adams as utterly selfless. He said she was among that rare breed of councillor who dedicated years of her life to helping. She was not interested in power as such. Power for her was the ability to get in among those disadvantaged people she cared about. She gave so much and made real sacrifices in her life to do so. She will be sorely missed by all who knew her and by the voluntary movement. Ms. Adams also served as president of Enfield Vision, the borough's charity for visually impaired people, and was a long-serving trustee of the Ruth Winston Centre for Older People in Palmer's Green. Diane De Jersey, chairwoman of Enfield Vision, said, Councillor Adams did an awful lot for blind people in Enfield. She supported us and often arranged for us to meet MPs and council officers. Ms. Adams attended private school in Southgate and lived in the borough all her life. Later in life, she worked for a Harley Street surgeon in central London. Former leader of the council's conservative group, Michael Lavender, said her political contributions were not infrequently interspersed with the most biting wit. She will be sadly missed.
Enfield council bosses believe the borough is on the verge of a new industrial revolution, heralded with a cash injection of £500,000 into a business centre. The money has been used to refurbish the Enfield Business Centre in Hertford Road, Enfield Wash, and comes from a £1.9 million pot won by the borough from the Mayor of London's Outer London Fund in 2012. It has been poured into refurbishing the centre with a new business hub, as well as a tranche of IT upgrades designed to help both local companies and job seekers. At the official launch, Council Leader Doug Taylor will say that the investment will fund a renaissance of industry in what was once the technological powerhouse of the capital. He told a gathering of business leaders, "Enfield's history is steeped in technology and innovation, and there is no reason why Enfield could not be a hub for industrial pioneers once more, which is why, through initiatives such as Enfield Business Centre, Enfield Council is committed to encouraging new businesses to flourish and prosper." There are also plans to announce a commitment to creating 40,000 new jobs, with thousands of pounds to be invested in training and skill development, which council leaders believe will lead to regeneration in industry and technology throughout the borough. Mr. Taylor said, "We will regenerate the area by continuing to create great conditions for business, help people find and keep jobs, support our local businesses to employ local residents, raise the skills and qualification levels of our population so that businesses can find the experts they need in our borough, attract additional investment to Enfield and increase the number of jobs available." Deputy Mayor of London, Kit Malthouse, will stand alongside Mr. Taylor as a sign of support for the initiative from the Mayor's office. Speaking before the launch, he said, "Helping the capital's business to thrive is a key priority, and supporting projects such as this one in Enfield demonstrates the reason the Outer London Fund was created. By supporting local entrepreneurs and workers who use this space, we can create an economic hub for generations to come."
A water company has been ordered to pay more than £82,000 in fines and costs for below-par repairs to the borough's roads. Thames Water admitted 15 breaches of the law regarding new roads and street works at Tottenham Magistrates Court on September the 4th. The company was fined £3,500 and ordered to pay costs of £1,963 for each offence. It was also told to pay a £120 victim surcharge, making a total of £82,065. Council chiefs decided to prosecute the utility giant after tests carried out between September 2013 and January this year found that 15 roads in the borough, which had been worked on by Thames Water, had been repaired inadequately. Independent tests commissioned by the council found the company had failed to replace the correct material to the correct thickness in roads that had been dug up. Roads tested by the council included Alma Road, Anderson Close, Crest Drive, East Duckleys Lane, Eversley Park Road, Fox Lane, Hartford Road, Lincoln Road, Middleham Road, Rosewood Drive, Sandhurst Road, Silver Street, Southbury Road, The Chine, Winchmore Hill Road and Bounces Lane. Enfield Council's Cabinet Member for Environment and Community Safety, Chris Bond, said, "We expect very high standards from utility companies when it comes to reinstating our roads. We would prefer to work with them to ensure high standards of work and in the majority of cases, there are absolutely no problems with the work carried out. When that is not the case, we will not hesitate to take firm and decisive action to address poor performance, including legal proceedings if necessary.
A councillor has expressed fears that the planned recommissioning of a range of health services could see new contracts awarded to private health firms undermining the NHS. Alev Kazimoglu, Labour member of Enfield Council's Health and Wellbeing Scrutiny Panel, said that Enfield Clinical Commissioning Group's proposed tendering of community health services could lead to a fragmented healthcare landscape from which private firms could cherry-pick the most profitable services. The warning came just days before the CCG holds a market testing information event for NHS bodies and private firms interested in running musculoskeletal services in Enfield, which includes orthopaedics, rheumatology, pain management and physiotherapy services. The Advertiser understands that a previous meeting about the £85 million five-year contract was attended by private health firm Circle, a private physiotherapy firm, the North Middlesex University Hospital and the Royal Free, which since July runs Barnet Hospital and Chase Farm. The Barnet, Enfield and Haringey Mental Health Trust currently provides MSK services for patients referred by Enfield GPs. Ms. Kazimoglu said, "I am concerned they are breaking services up into little packages, allowing the private sector to cherry-pick the ones that are profitable with strong bids. If the provider for this contract is a private firm, this will make the Mental Health Trust less viable. This is part of the ongoing NHS sell-off, which is leading to a chaotic situation within the health service. Under the controversial 2012 Health and Social Care Act, health commissioners are required to put virtually all services out through competitive markets, which critics say is rapidly increasing the involvement of private firms in the NHS. But the CCG, which aims to sign a contract with a lead provider in order to avoid past duplication of services and confusing access for patients, said it was really proud of the work it was doing in regards to MSK services. It also said the recommissioning of community health services were completely separate to this tendering process." Liz Wise, the CCG's chief officer, added, "An immense amount of work is going into finding out what our patients really need and value." She said, "New and innovative services would be developed."
Organisers of a local festival believe it is growing year on year. The Palmer's Green Festival welcomed thousands of people to Brimfield Park on Sunday, September the 7th, as it hosted stalls, international cuisine and community groups. Festival founder Phillip Shard said, "The festival has continued to grow year on year and demonstrates that local people want to get together and celebrate our diverse community. We estimate that approaching 10,000 people came out to enjoy themselves. There was something for everyone, from entertainment for children to a new project aimed at the older members of our community. And in addition to the established dance zone and bandstand performances, we had a stage on the old bowling green. Music on the Green, organised by local musician and promoter Lester Clayton, showcased local musical talent and was also a huge success. The festival also hosted a Friendship Zone, launched by the Ruth Winston Centre in Palmer's Green, to help older people take part in community activities. Representative Yvonne Quigley said, "It was a wonderful place for people to come and gather information and advice from a number of organisations in the borough and hopefully solve some of their needs and those of their loved ones. The Community Friendship Zone was an excellent opportunity for us to work together to break isolation and engage with the older community in the hope of encouraging them to join an activity or group across the borough and seek the companionship they need. We look forward to carrying on our work throughout the year on many projects."
The construction of the first council homes in the borough in more than 30 years is set to come one step closer to becoming reality this week. Enfield Council's cabinet is expected to approve phase two of a project that will see at least 100 new homes built on 8 small housing sites across the borough. Initial work has been started across 7 sites by construction firm Keir, and a report going before the Cabinet tonight proposes to add an 8th site in Ordnance Road, Enfield Lock, to the plans. The council, faced with more than 2,000 households in temporary accommodation, wants to build at least 100 family homes for rent on the different locations to respond to the huge demand for affordable rented properties. Amit Oikana, Cabinet Member for Housing, said the new homes would be under full council ownership, a model which would benefit the authority and Enfield taxpayers. He told the Advertiser, "We really need more affordable and rented properties because lots of people are not in a position to buy a home, and we have thousands of families in temporary accommodation. The scheme will benefit the council as well because we will own the homes and will raise income to build more in the future. It will give us flexibility to look for more sites for development." The council expects the scheme's first 3 homes of the scheme, which is being financed largely through borrowing and will be delivered through a council-owned company known as New Foundations, to be completed in St George's Road, Enfield, in late spring next year. All 8 sites had been used previously for sheltered housing for the elderly, but the buildings were no longer in use. Of the new homes, 60% will be rented out at the normal market rate, while the remainder will be rented out at affordable rates, set at 80% of market rate and below. Mr. Oikana added that he was looking into letting out the properties on tenancies which are exempt from right to buy. The scheme under which tenants can buy their home for a considerable discount until the housing crisis is over. The council expects all of the homes to be completed by spring 2016.
Stout walking boots and a love of pounding the pavements are the new, unusual must-haves for anyone who wants to work at an electrical wholesaler's in the borough. Tim Cunningham, 40, who works in customer sales at AW Electrical on the Great Cambridge Trading Estate in Ponders End, company directors William Oliveri, 35, and his brother Anthony, 31, and 4 of their regular customers, trekked on Saturday. Setting out at 9:20 a.m. from Putney Bridge in West London, the team finished just under 24 hours later on Sunday morning at Henley-on-Thames in Oxfordshire after walking through the night. They all raised money for separate charities close to their hearts and totaled £7,000 for the good causes. William chose Nightingale Cancer Support Centre in Lancaster Road, Enfield. So far, he has raised £780 and is aiming for £1,000. Talking to the Advertiser about why the group decided to take on the challenge, Tim said, "About 3 months ago, we all walked up Mount Snowdon as part of a charity fundraiser, and we all felt that we could do more for charity, that we could go further. We then found out about this Thames Path Walk and thought that sounded like a good challenge." However, Tim of Church Street, Edmonton, admitted that some of the team did a bit more training than others, although he refused to name names. He explained that one of the training walks the team had undergone took them from King's Cross in central London along the Hertford Canal to Stratford and then up to Stansted Abbots in Hertfordshire. "That walk took us 8 hours to complete, and I don't even think we had much of a drink once we got up there," he added. "And despite the blisters and exhaustion that came with walking all day and all night along the banks of the Thames, Tim revealed that the team were determined to take on another, even more grueling challenge, all in a bid to raise even more money for their chosen charities. "We are definitely going to do something big next time," he said. "We aren't sure yet if it will be by bike or by foot, but we can say it will be a big one."
An Enfield councillor has been suspended from the Labour Party after allegedly striking a man during an altercation. Councillor for Hazelbury Ward, Haydar Ullis, was suspended after a video seen by the Enfield Independent was released showing a man throwing three punches. A spokesman for the London Labour Party said, an Enfield councillor involved in a police investigation has been suspended by the Labour Party. Councillor Haydar Ullis, who was elected to Enfield Borough Council earlier this year, is the subject of an immediate administrative suspension, barring him from representing the Labour Party pending the outcome of the police investigation. An Enfield Council spokesman said, Enfield Council understands that legal proceedings are active in relation to this matter. We cannot comment any further.
Community groups have been called upon to apply for a slice of the new Enfield Residents Priority Fund. The fund, which started in 2011, is worth £700,000, and there has been a change to the rules for the next set of grants. To cut costs, the fund has been reduced by almost a third, and new criteria have been introduced. Single applications cannot be more than £5,000. Organisations may only submit one application in a ward during the year, and plans must not duplicate existing council or voluntary and community projects. The council is also encouraging volunteering or training opportunities as part of proposed bits for the money. Councillor Yasmin Brett, Cabinet Member for Community Organisations, said, the Enfield Residents Priority Fund remains a hugely popular initiative. Since 2011, nearly 600 projects worth £5.6 million have been developed and delivered by residents and groups working with their local ward councillors. We are keen that the ERPF continues from strength to strength, so once again we are putting a call out to any local people who would like to make a bid to the fund to find out more and apply.